So I'm here to talk to you about the art and science of image search, the art, science, and commerce of image search. And essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a commercial lens on machine learning and computer vision. And so who am I? I'm John. I went to Stony Brook as an undergrad back in 92. I studied computer science and math. I came here in 96. I graduated in 99 with a master's in computer science. I started some of my first businesses around that time. They were all small software products. They always needed images in order for me to sell them. So I always had to go find those images. And I realized early on that you can't just take images off the web if you want to use them commercially. People will hunt you down and get very upset with you. So licensing images through the commercial services at the time which existed, which were Getty, for one. Corbis was another that doesn't exist anymore. But they weren't quite perfect, and I wanted to figure out a better way to do it. So I shot about 30,000 images in a year in 2003. I picked all the subjects I could find, and I looked at kind of what companies were using. An example would be your Contact Us page. For any company out there, you need a friendly, welcoming person, probably wearing a headset, ready to answer your call. Today we have thousands of those images. We didn't have any of those back then. So I would shoot those. I would hire a model off Craigslist. I would literally put a headset on them, put them in front of my computer in my one-bedroom apartment in Gramercy Park and start taking pictures. it worked. At that time, all I had was 30,000 images. People were actually buying these images. So I invited other people to come in and shoot. People were downloading my images. People were downloading other people's images. I started to learn how the marketplace would work. I was watching what people would buy. And over time, I got kind of a good handle on what it would take to start this image marketplace. And so I continued from there. My 30,000 images are still actually there. They don't sell too well compared to what we have today. And that's not very surprising. We have about 150 million assets today. And ever since day one, image search was a problem. It was a problem we had to solve, and we had to find creative ways to do it. Back when we had 30,000 images, it wasn't that hard. But then it got more and more difficult as we went. And in 2003, this is what our search function looked like. I was a Perl programmer, and literally what this thing does is execute an SQL statement on a MySQL table and literally search by keyword. And you can enter any number of keywords, and it'll look at the keywords table and try to figure out, maybe you've selected a category if you want to get fancy, and it would just dump all those photos out, and we would paginate them, and you can see and buy images. This is 20 lines of code back then. Today, our search engine is millions of lines of code. It's about 2.2 million lines of code, and I'm going to go into some detail as to why that happened and what our search engine consists of and how we got more complicated. And if I tried to put that on a slide today, it would take actually 100,000 slides like this one to show you what that looks like, but I'm not going to do that. So what's machine learning? Machine learning is essentially a subset of AI. It allows computers to iteratively learn without being explicitly programmed. It involves creating a function which is designed and trained to predict something. It's a function that looks a lot like how the brain works. Neurons, synapses, and kind of layers of learning to kind of get to a final outcome. That's smarter than you would have been able to program in a functional kind of way. It draws from lots of fields like statistics, math, computer science, and the data that you have is key. So machine learning is changing everything. We hear about this every day. Self-driving cars, devices that listen to everything you do and get smarter as you talk to them. Voice interfaces, the advertisements you see every day on Facebook are driven by machine learning. There are medical applications for cancer detection, and I'm sure you guys are learning about even much more than that every day. So why do we need it? Again, you can only provide so much instruction to a computer in a functional kind of way, and you won't be able to compete with other people around you if they're using a machine learning algorithm and you're using explicit instructions to tell a computer what to do. Over time, it'll minimize cost, maximize value, and giving a machine millions of examples of questions and answers to produce a model will result in a system where a computer will be able to answer questions that you wouldn't have been able to provide those answers before. And so you're essentially teaching a computer kind of how to live on its own and be pretty independent from continuous instruction by the operator, instead by it gets better and better by the model. So why is this happening now? Even 20 years ago when I was here as a student, machine learning and AI were pretty buzzy words. We talked about them all the time, but lately a lot has changed in the past few years, and the reason is the growth in data. We're producing a lot of data every day with all the actions that we act on, and computers in the background are collecting this and getting smarter and smarter about how to interpret that data. The GPU was a pretty important part of all of this. CPUs are great at a lot of things, but when it comes to matrix multiplication, which is the thing that makes machine learning so amazing, GPUs really excel at that. GPUs are getting cheaper, faster. They're available in cloud environments like Amazon, and you can get them in desktop computers that can run pretty advanced stuff. So this kind of cross between this growth in data and the growth in the computing power that we see today with GPUs kind of took this leap, and that's been the past few years. So why Shutterstock? We have a lot of data. We serve up most of stock imagery pages today. If you search for stock photo of something, you're more likely to get one of our pages than another page. We've been fortunate to have some amazing SEO and other types of programmers come through Shutterstock, and a lot of them are still there that understand really how Google works and other search engines, and we show up a lot. We've also been pretty good at building the brand, so a lot of that traffic is repeat. So you can kind of see us up there, and you can kind of see Getty down there. And Getty was around for about 10 years before we started, so I'm pretty proud of kind of how far we've gotten. The other thing is, search produces a lot of data, and we produce about a billion searches every single month. So what are some of the areas of opportunity that machine learning can help us at Shutterstock? So every single one of these red boxes. So essentially, we take in about 2 million images every week from people that contribute photos to us that they want to sell. You can sign up tomorrow for an account and upload a photo very easily from your phone. One of those images that you upload will be hand-reviewed by someone. We want to remove some of that manual process and try to do that more mechanically over time. So that's kind of where the ingestion process can be improved using machine learning. And the review process also. So we have about, say, 400 or 500 reviewers at any moment around the world reviewing these 2 million images every single week. They read all of the keywords that are uploaded with the image, and they try to make sure the description makes sense. Because one of the other things we do is translate that description and those keywords into 21 different languages. So we want to make sure that the data is clean as it possibly can be for someone looking at a photo for 15 seconds with its metadata. Machine learning can help us make that data more accurate. It could help us figure out kind of some of the things that trip our algorithms over time, and we want to get better at that. Our users on the site, the buyers on our site, helping them get to the user quicker, helping that user get to the image quicker, helping that user get to download that image that they really need to drive their business is important to us. So if ML can help us with that, and it turns out it can, and I'll show you later, that's very beneficial. And the download itself, that's a piece of behavioral data that we use in a pretty important way. We're approaching the 1 billionth image that we will sell sometime in the next year or so, and so that's a lot of data. It's probably the most data we know about of businesses that are using images to make money and how they're searching through that our catalog and downloading those images. And if we can kind of harness that data in other ways, we can make businesses even more successful. So computer vision is a subset of machine learning. And I'm going to go into some examples of how we use computer vision at Shutterstock. But I just want to go back to a paper that kind of changed everything back in 2012 by three students or professors at University of Toronto. The paper is called ImageNet Classification with Deep Convolutional Neural Networks. And I have to admit, I've read this paper a few times and it's way over my head. Some of you may be able to understand this a lot better than I have, but we have a team of people that took this paper and kind of ran with it at Shutterstock, and we've done some amazing things with it. A lot of what has come out of this paper has been used in tools like TensorFlow and Cafe and some of the tools we use every day to drive some of our machine learning algorithms that are based on a lot of open source stuff that any of you can download tonight and actually start using. It's pretty amazing stuff. So on the right is a representation of the neural network that this paper was based off of. This is over my head. I wish I understood this stuff a little bit better, but each kind of phase and those boxes are each a layer where the computer gets smarter and smarter based on information. Early on, it may understand colors in image and what that means, and over time, it can extract features, and using a training set of comparing features to objects, it'll know that this is a microphone, for instance, in that photo. This is an image from that paper, actually. And what you can see on the left is what the computer sees. So what the computer is doing is it's essentially kind of extracting out these features from these images. And early on in the training data set, if you have clean data and you're able to associate features with keywords, you can do amazing things like keyword an entire image without anybody entering any keywords at all, which is where we want to get to at Shutterstock. And today, if you were to upload a photo to sell, like I mentioned before, you have to provide a description. You also have to provide keywords, 20 to 50 keywords. And those keywords are used in our search today. But if we can generate those ourselves, we can probably be more accurate over time. And we could save you a lot of time so that you can shoot more photos and we can sell more of them in better ways. So the reason why we kind of got here is because language is pretty difficult when it comes to our business. We have 150 million images on our site. We have 300,000 contributors. We get 2 million images every week. Each one of those images has 20 keywords supplied in English by the contributor, no matter where you live in the world. I'll get back to that. And a description of that image. So if you're typing these keywords in English and you live somewhere, you're from somewhere where English is not your first language, you may not be entering the right keywords. And if you are interested in getting more traffic to your images, you may provide us with keywords that may not necessarily match that image. And so there's lots of different reasons why language is hard at Shutterstock and why we want to make it so that computers can actually see and we can be less reliant on language. And I'm going to get into some more of those examples. So here's an example of an image on our site. And just to kind of illustrate, you can probably think of, you know, 5 or 10 keywords that would match this image. You can, you know, robot, arm, factory, industrial, assembly line, all of that. This is work that we don't want a human to do, and we can actually get a computer to do that kind of stuff. An image is worth 1,000 words, like we've all heard, but for you to actually sit down and make this image equate to 1,000 words is actually a lot of work. And there'll probably be some mistakes along the way, so we want to kind of take that out of the picture. We also translate all those keywords into 21 languages, and if you provide us with one of the wrong keywords, and we translate one of those keywords into another language the wrong way, it kind of propagates the problem all the way throughout our website into a complete mess, and makes it so that our international customers aren't able to find these images also. automatic translation is actually pretty complicated too. So, you know, if we look at this image and we translate robotic arm, that may not translate right into 21 different languages. It may be a different word. If we can back in again from a training set and get better keywords for this image in native languages, it'll improve our customer experience, and we'll be able to back to commerce, sell more images, which is our goal every day. So here's an example of an image on our site actually today, and the actual keywords that you'll see if you go to this image. That's the ID. So if you actually search for it, you're going to find it. And there's the title: color bike, small parts of bike in sunny day bike series. Obviously not ideal, but someone typed this in. It's on our website, and if we could use kind of reverse our way back into describing this image from a computational point of view, we can probably come up with a better title. The keywords were kind of entered in a way where the user would get as much exposure for their image. You can't blame them. The more times they sell their image, the more we pay them. We paid out about $500 million to our contributors over the past 10 years, and the more exposure you get, the more money you'll make. So we also use machine learning algorithms to and behavioral data to remove keywords that don't matter, so that when you type woman on motorbike, this does not come up. And we've been able to filter a lot of that out. Again, there's a lot of work to do, but when you have a crowdsourced marketplace, there's only so much you can do. And so we do our best. Words have multiple meanings. If you search for a jaguar, you're going to get jaguars that are animals, and you're going to get jaguars that are cars. And if we can understand more about what your business does, we can probably provide better images. But also, if we can describe these images in a better way, we can get better outcomes for our customers. This is an actual search result, which is not ideal, something we're not proud of, that we're trying to get better at. Black car, red bike will actually return these photos. But we're getting better at trying to discern what you mean and how we can get better. But again, an illustration of how language is not perfect, and if we can just use machines to do a lot more of this work than what our contributors are providing, we'll get to a better outcome. So let's look at some examples of how we're training machines to look at images at Shutterstock. So essentially, we start by training a model. We supply our network with an image and a corresponding label for that image. And the task of this network is to predict the label of the image. And then we compare the predicted label with the actual label. If the prediction was correct, we strengthen the neuron connections that led to that decision. And if not, we weaken them. So we kind of run this training set through our algorithm. We use data of actual people that have downloaded photos. Chances are, if they search for something and then they downloaded a photo, there's a likelihood that keyword is associated with that photo. That's part of the training set. If the keyword is not, we pull back a bit and kind of pull the training algorithm back, and then at runtime, what happens is we use the trained model to search through the different vectors that we've created for each one of our images, and we take the keyword you've searched with, vectors associated with that keyword, the images in our database, the features and the vectors associated with that image in our database, and we try to match them, and we get some better results than just searching by keyword. And the next few slides, I'll show kind of how this model works. So there's a welder on the left, and what we're trying to do is find images that are similar to that image in our library. And when the model's young, you can see that it's relying on pretty general themes to make decisions. So in this case, you can see it recognizes that there's blue as a dominant color, and it kind of finds other images that are blue, but those images are nothing like that welder image. But we run the algorithm for a little while and it gets a little smarter. It starts to understand concepts. It understands that there's essentially someone welding, except it'll make some mistakes, like the violinist in there. It kind of can mix up with with the welding image. But we try to get the model to be smarter, so we run it for a little while longer, and essentially we converge to this place. So what our algorithm at this point has done is gotten us to a place where we can take the image on the left, not supply any keywords to our search engine, and suddenly the images on the right are returned. I'll show you another example later, but what you can do now on the Shutterstock website is take an image like the one on the left that you may not have a license for, and you may say, well, I kind of want to use an image like this in my brochure for my welding equipment. You can drag and drop that image into our search bar today. You can try this on our website, and the images on the right will return. So that's an actual search result, which is pretty powerful if you think about it. So now any one of our customers can find an image that they don't have the license to and actually find one that looks pretty damn similar that they can license. So we're pretty proud of that. That's live on our site today. And so I'll go through another example, and this one gets interesting too. So let's say that image on the left is the one we want to find in our library. And so at first you can see again, the algorithm is mostly relying on colors. Run a bit longer and deeper through many more layers, and it starts to understand the content of the image. There's a person in there. We call it a person. Obviously the computer has no idea, but it's starting to look at those features and it finds these people. But we don't really want people that look like people. We want people that look like this abstract kind of artistic view of a person on the left. And run a bit longer, actually it can go too far. We can then kind of intervene and tell the algorithm that it needs to take a step back. It'll then learn to kind of take these neurons and assign a negative weight to them. And so it kind of snaps back pretty quickly into this research result. And so if you think about a creative director at a big agency at using the Shutterstock website, they're trying to create an ad campaign with a feeling like the image on the left, they can get a lot closer than they would have normally. They get the images on the right if they drag that image on the left into our search bar. If you try to search for the image on the left, think of what you would try to search for: abstract face, geometric face. I can guarantee you that these are not the types of results that you're going to get. The ones on the right, you're going to get something a lot different. So this creates kind of a new way for our customers to search through our catalog, and it's been pretty successful. And actually, people that use our reverse image search wind up buying a lot more images on our website over time. So if we can actually, it's a big UX hurdle to get someone actually to do this, but when we do it, they turn to a very loyal customer. And so we try to do that a lot. We want more loyal customers. So let me show you some examples of other examples of how we're doing this today. So cats are pretty important on the internet, so we're using a cat example here. And essentially, you start with a keyword search for this example: Maine Coon cat. And let's say the one I'm interested in is the one, the second one in. The Shutterstock website consists of four pages. There's the search results page, which is the one you're looking at here. There's the asset details page, which illustrates the asset, and you can download the asset. There's the logged out home page and the logged in home page. Pretty simple website. Still millions of lines of code, but pretty simple website, four pages. So if you click on that image, and you can, again, try this. This is the search result you'll get if you try it. That second one in, you'll see on our asset details page these similar images on the bottom. And what they're essentially using the algorithm that I described to you before. They're using the pixel data from that image, to get to the search results below. And so before we did this, you would just kind of find the asset on top and you'd have the download button. But now, not only are we giving you that asset, but we're giving you eight other images that kind of look like it. And we found that this actually increases the number of downloads, increases revenue, increases the amount we can pay our contributors, gets some more images in the long run. And this is another kind of example of how computer vision has improved the company's revenue stream, essentially. Here's another example. So that church on the left If you try to search for stained glass windows, you're going to find the search result on the right. I can pretty much guarantee that no matter what you try to find that image on the left, you're going to run into a lot of difficulty. And so if you found, if you're looking for this type of image and you want something like it to use in on your website, you can drag that image on the left into the search bar. And like the examples I went through earlier, these are the results you get. And so this is the kind of thing that you cannot do with keywords. Even if our keywords were as clean as possible and they didn't have all of the errors I was talking about before, like keywords that didn't make sense to the image or incorrect translations because English may not be your first language, or a fuzzy translation because we use an automated translation system to convert the keyword into 21 languages, you still wouldn't get this result. So it's pretty amazing. It's a pretty amazing customer experience. And again, this is something that improves our customers' lives every day. Here's another example. This image is really complex to describe. There's water, there's some kind of weird slime. Maybe it's ice, who knows? It's kind of pretty, it's a sunset. You can try all of these keywords, you will not find this image. I can guarantee it. But if you took this image and dropped it into our search engine, you would get these results. So it's pretty cool to be able to get someone to their desired commercially released image that they don't have to worry about for their business from an image that they're not sure if they can license or not, and they probably shouldn't. Keywording is, as I mentioned, another way that today this is a live feature on our website. So if you were to upload a photo today from your phone and you want to sell it, we provide suggested keywords. These suggested keywords are ones we believe based on features in the image that we think are associated with that image. And what you can do is, without even typing, you can just kind of pick the ones that match and then hit submit. And we're getting more and more data. Actually, this is behavioral data. So what happens here is some of those keywords are selected, some of them are not. The ones that are not, we can use over time to weaken, again, those neurons. And the ones that they select, we can use to strengthen. So over time, we can get smarter and smarter. And maybe some of these wouldn't appear in this image. Like branch, there's no branch. So if people are not selecting branch over time, we would, for features in this type of image, not include the keyword branch as a suggestion. So those are some of the things that are actually in production on the website that you can see today. I'm going to show you some stuff that is not actually in production yet at Shutterstock, which is kind of cool, and will soon be a part of our product. So one of the things that's happening is we've improved our model. So not only did we use that initial training set, but we went even deeper with the behavioral data, and we look at a lot more data, and we're able to solve the lemur problem, which has become a pretty interesting problem at Shutterstock, and a lot of people talk about the lemur problem every day. At one point, I had to ask someone what the lemur problem was, and I learned that this is what it is. If you drag and drop a lemur image into our search bar, you get the images on the left today. Our new model, which we haven't pushed yet, will release the. We'll show you the images on the right. And again, over time, what we've used is the positive and negative data to strengthen and weaken the neurons in order to get to the result on the right. And so on the left is a graphical representation of what that algorithm looks like. And you'll soon see this model go live on our website. So if you search for lemur today, actually, you drag a lemur image in to our search bar, you're going to get the results on the left. We want you to get the results on the right, and soon you'll see the results on the right. Another example is compositionally aware search. And here's the next one. So we essentially used our trained model to convert the image into a bunch of vectors. And when we did that, we understand where in those images those vectors lie. So we use the geometric information, the x and y axis of where those features are to deliver this next feature. Again, this is our UX, our test dev environment, and we're trying to figure out how to deliver this best to the customer. Today, this is in test. So we have probably 15 to 20 customers a month that dial in. We test this with them. They're actual customers, and we learn how they can use this and how we can deliver this feature to them. So let's say you're searching for, let's see if I can remember what this one is, chair and lamp, but you're very, it's very important where the chair is and where the lamp is. So what you can do here is you can put the chair on the left, lamp on the right, and you get images where that vector feature of chair appears on the left and the vector feature of the lamp appears on the right. Let's switch them. You get the opposite. So you can really kind of get down to the exact image, not only the exact features of the image you want, but the location of those features in that image. And I think this is a pretty amazing thing. I think our customers are going to be pretty psyched when they start to learn how to use it. Here's another one. So this one's called copy space. So often you want an image, you want to use a certain type of image, and you want to put copy in a certain place in that image, and you want the background of the image to be either very clear, or very, or you may want some dimensionality to the background of the image. So here you search for women, you got all these images. Let's say you're selling something and you want to put some words on this image, or you want to put your logo on this image, and it has to be in a specific spot, and you need a place to put other elements in this image. So what the user is going to do is they're going to select where they want copy space, where they want blank space. And so as you can see, the user is selecting copy space on the right, you get an image with more copy space on the right that you can add other features and text. Here that you want it on both sides, you get it on both sides. Here you can also adjust the background. So let's say you want something more interesting in the background, you pull that lever to the right, you get some backgrounds. If you want more of kind of a green screen type effect, so maybe you want to extract that person out and put them into another image, you're going to want nothing in the background. So you kind of pull that lever all the way to the left, and that's kind of how this example started. Another thing we're doing, we're getting a lot further into workflow tools. So we don't want to just be the place where people buy images. We also want to be the place where people manipulate images, edit images, and kind of do different things with their imagery. So one thing that's happened is one thing we've built is an editor, in-browser editor. And we started to learn that people were using that editor mostly to crop the image. So we thought, if we know where certain features are in images, how can we get smarter about helping them crop? And maybe we can crop that image without them even doing anything or selecting the crop. So you see a Facebook image. Let's say we're creating a Facebook ad. That's a good crop for a Facebook ad in your feed. If you're using a Facebook cover, you'd use the one on the right. So again, people use our images in commercial settings. They're using them for their social presence in order to make money off that social presence. How can we reduce one step in their process so that they can focus on what really matters to their work and provide them with 9 different crops for anything from Facebook to Pinterest to an email header without them even doing any work? We do this actually at Shutterstock all the time. We spend our marketing budget this year is close to $80 million, and we spend a lot of money sending out emails and creating Facebook campaigns and creating different paid links in Google. We often need to create different aspect ratios of different sized images for those creatives. We have people doing it manually today, and this is the kind of tool that can help us create more versions of these images quicker so that we can deploy our ads into more locations. So if you think about Shutterstock as its own customer, we find tools like this pretty interesting. And when we find it interesting with our marketing budget, we tend to find that our customers and their marketing budgets find it interesting as well.